This is Audiovisual Cultures, the podcast that explores different areas of the arts and culture of production with me, Paula Blair. Visit patreon.com/AVcultures to find out more and to join the pod. Welcome to another Audiovisual Cultures podcast. I'm Paula Blair, and boy, do I have a treat for you today. I am beyond excited to welcome filmmaker and historian Dr. Gary D. Rhodes. Gary, thank you so much for joining me. How are you and where do we find you?
Well, we find us in many places during a pandemic. Mainly, I suppose the best answer is at home, like we're so often confined. Let me start by saying thanks so much for inviting me to talk. I've known of your research for years, and so it's always great to have the chance to chat with you. Though I'm physically in Orlando, Florida now, part of my heart always belongs to the north of Ireland, where we first met. But more than anything else, the best answer, like I guess we would all give, is I'm at home, you know, in the middle of this horrendous plague.
That's it. Just as you mentioned it there anyway, Gary, and just for listeners, so Gary and I have known each other for, I would say, longer than either of us wants to admit to.
That's the gray hair of mine. My gray hair, anyway.
Mine's coming. Well, mine's on the way.
The later the better, in my book. There's always hair dye. I'm definitely considering that right now.
Myself. Oh, you look great. You look
wonderful. You're too kind.
You've always looked fabulous. I had the privilege of being taught by Gary when he arrived at Queen's University Belfast in 2005, and that was the final year of my undergraduate degree. And you also were the internal examiner for my PhD, which is very exciting. Do you remember that?
Oh, I remember all of it very well. I was so excited to get to Belfast and to Queen's, and it was so great. The entire cohort of students you were part of were such extremely creative, intelligent, and dedicated students, far more than I'd worked with at the undergraduate level before. It was extremely exciting. And of course, we shared an interest in Irish cinema, and that became, of course, core to your PhD work. And so I was so proud to be a small part of that process and your success with that project.
That's very kind. Gary, you've been writing more books than I can keep up with. So I think it'd be nice to start talking about some of them, if that's okay, and really get into your research areas. So we'll see where you want to go with this. It might be good to get the most recent thing out of the way, because what we're all living through at the minute is quite relevant to something you've been working on anyway. Would you like to tell us a bit about how cinema has been affected by epidemics research?
Of course. Thank you. Yeah, thank you for that question. It's an area of research that became very interesting to me many years ago. I was actually an undergraduate at the time, and I was going through, as interested in film history, I was going through these old publications like Variety, The Hollywood Reporter, and all of those, and I would be turning the pages in them, looking for things of interest to me on subjects like the horror film, one of my other areas of interest. But I kept seeing over and over again in these old publications, yellowing, crumbling publications from the 1920s, 30s, 40s, I kept seeing so many movie theater tragedies that had affected audiences. And some of them we maybe know a little bit about. A film like Inglourious Basterds, the Quentin Tarantino film, for example, picks up on the flammability of film and the fact that film fires sometimes happened that could kill people. And so I was seeing those things as they occurred in America in these old newspapers, these old trade publications. And I kept seeing them over and over again. And I started photocopying all of them because I thought, I'd never heard about this. And it was fires and it was bombings and it was sometimes murders that people would use the darkness of the movie theater to shoot another person, for example. A lot of these very tragic stories, but I found them quite interesting in that they were so forgotten. And it ended up culminating in a book of mine about a decade ago called The Perils of Movie Going in America. You know, all these regrettably bad things that could happen by just going to the movies. But one part of it that I should now introduce is the fact that along with everything I've just mentioned and other horrors, you know, there were unfortunately, you know, people would get groped, frankly, in the darkness, you know, so there was sexual assaults and things that would happen. I mean, a lot of this, of course, exacerbated by the cover of Darkness, because, you know, it's a rather interesting thing, although we're so used to it in today's world, to go into a movie theater and sit in the darkness with strangers all around us. You know, that was a rather new thing to do at the end of the 19th century, to plunge into darkness with strangers. But with all of the horrible things that could happen, one of the others that became a chapter was the sheer number of pandemics and epidemics that affected movie going a century ago, and even a little more recent. The most famous of them would have been the 1918 influenza, the great influenza pandemic. So much has been said of it lately. We're a century later. It's, I suppose, in pandemic terms, the nearest example, the nearest touchstone for us during all of this. That's true for our movie-going situation as well. And so that became so much of what I was writing about in that book, although there were other epidemics like polio, like scarlet fever. Those tended to be more regional in America, more short-term, you know, shutting down a theater for a few weeks. Sometimes they were more strictly demographic. You know, sometimes the theaters would remain open during polio epidemics, but children weren't admitted because they were the ones that would contract polio. But the pandemic of 1918 caused most theaters in America to shut for about half of 1918, and in an eerie precursor to today's world, to reopen and then have to shut again.
Right.
Because of surges of second waves, you know, the desire for everybody for their own mental health, but also on the exhibitor's side of the fence to start making money again, to not go out of business, to be able to sell movie theater seats again, tickets again. So this is something of my research. It actually began when I was an undergraduate. It ended up being a book.
Wow.
And it's interesting how, I don't know if it's the return of the repressed or what it is, but you can do a project and then years later, only years later, is its relevance maybe, or it becomes more relevant, you know, the research, because right when the pandemic hit and everything began to shut in America in March of 2020, I got a phone call from the Chicago Tribune saying, hey, it looks like you're the only person that, you know, has written about this before. And then that led to me talking more about it, writing my own op-eds about it in the New York Daily News and elsewhere, because it's one of those moments where hopefully, you know, our research can have meaning for the world outside of a dusty library shelf.
Yeah, wow. I mean, in a way, it quite fits with your interest in horror, because it is quite all horrific in its own way, that stuff.
Yes, very much so. In fact, my op-ed in the New York Daily News was published at Halloween last year.
Oh.
And it was actually, in some ways, drawing the very connection you're talking about, including the Red Death and Poe's famous story, The Mask of the Red Death, to our present situation. Because a lot of horror films have been, and horror stories traditionally have been about plague, both real, like the bubonic plague, as well as kind of concocted, like Poe's story did, creating a plague for the sake of scaring people. And these things have continued through the years. You know, I know there's films like Contagion have obviously been watched probably and thought about probably as much or more the past year as when they were first, you know, released. So there is a very scary, you know, connection here. One of George Romero's most fascinating horror films, you know where I'm going, is you always are two steps ahead of me. But The Crazies he made, of course, Romero having been the director of Night of the Living Dead and Dawn of the Dead, most famously. But he made a film of The Crazies about an epidemic. And of course, that was remade, even World War Z, you know, some of the zombie craze of recent years. Some of the stories about how the zombies get started are epidemic related. As I recall, it was probably the first season of The Walking Dead where the journey of survival was leading to the CDC in America, in the Center for Disease Control. And that's another odd thing. I haven't really thought that much about it or written that much about it, but clearly there is a curiosity, however accidental, in so many zombie films in America being about epidemics, pandemics in the years, not too many years before and leading up to our present situation.
I think 28 Days Later, it comes from monkeys. So there's that species jump that happens, which is quite interesting to think about now.
Oh, yes, which is very fascinating. fascinating because obviously there's talks about where did this come from? Was it from a bat or so forth? And that's been true of some prior diseases and epidemics and so forth in human history. You know, are they originating from other species and animals? It's true of the folklore too, isn't it? Because, you know, you get bit by a vampire bat. unless you like vampires, and sometimes I do, but either woe to you or hurrah. But there is that characteristic, you're right. And 28 days later was such a watershed moment, I think, for a lot of us that are interested in horror films and interested in British horror films and how it was seen at the time to really inject new life into, and maybe inject in a pandemic world is even an interesting word, but inject new life into the British horror film that was so well known in the 60s and 70s. And it's very much, again, akin to and maybe prescient of our current situation, which certainly I don't mean to make light of. We're trying to study and understand it and not make light of it. But I do think that there's some interesting, there's a lot of interesting connections between horror and plagues, including our current pandemic.
Yeah, I suppose it's that thing of playing out scenarios, I find, in the arts. So the movies are, they're imagining, right, well, if that happened, this could be the series of events that happens. And, you know, what if people are in their own movies at the minute? I suppose it's a way of understanding what's happening to us because we're put in our little boxes when we're stuck at home. I suppose we've only got our imagination. I don't really know where I'm going with that. I'm just thinking through if it's just playing out scenarios of what could potentially happen, because there's such a big difference between a movie like Zombieland and 28 Days Later. One's very serious and the other one isn't, but yet they're about essentially the same thing.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, and that makes my mind go fascinating in so many places, the your thoughts there, because you're raising so many interesting issues. And I think that certainly there's this fascinating connection between horror and comedy.
Yeah.
You know, as genres, maybe two sides of the same coin, sometimes they've been said to say. I think that they're two of the most consistently popular genres in film history. Mm. They both emerge basically in the 1890s, and they really don't have much of a period of disappearing on us in the way that, say, musicals or westerns do. The consistent popularity of both, and everything from what we might call dark comedy, which can be so often in horror films, to the fact that comedy itself is, I think, inherently subversive. Mm. Somebody is so often on the butt end of the joke, so to speak, you know, that maybe a lot of people are laughing, children, you know, on a playground, but then there's the one crying because they're the one being made fun of. You know, comedy can be rather in its own way so cruel. Mm. So I think that there's some real connections there. And I think that that's true throughout horror film history, that we see it play out in two basic ways. That one would be that the serious horror films in many cases would inject moments of comic relief. The idea, particularly in eras like the 1920s, 30s, and afterwards, 40s, 50s, we'll have something really scary, but then we'll have somebody make a joke of it a couple of minutes later to help. The idea was to relieve the tension of the moviegoer that's just been put through the trauma of screen terror. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the other trajectory, if there's two main ones, the other trajectory would be that kind of Zombieland approach, mm-hmm. where the horror and comedy are combined at once into something that may be dark. I mean, one of the things that always attracted me about a certain types of Irish literature, mm-hmm. including Beckett, you know, would be the darkly comic sensibilities. And I think horror at times has gone down that road, where horror and comedy are, in other words, hand in hand in creating the sensations, and sometimes at those moments, very peculiar sensations and emotional responses. Because, you know, when it's something's darkly comic, does it frighten us? Do we laugh? Mm-hmm. Should we laugh? Mm-hmm. Is it an uncomfortable kind of laughter? I think all of that's very fascinating. And I think you're right that the imagination can help in these ways. And sometimes it's maybe life imitating art or art imitating life. And maybe it's an interesting, I think, in the history of horror, even thinking back before cinema, you know, literature, painting, visual culture, folklore, there's kind of, I think, an interesting kind of dance macabre here. When you talk about 28 Days Later, I'm reminded one of my forthcoming publications is about the unproduced film Revolt of the Dead, which would have been a 1932 or late 32, early 33 film directed by Todd Browning.
Okay.
Browning was a very, you know Browning, a lot of the listeners probably do. He made the 1931 Dracula. Mm-hmm. He made the 1932 film Freaks. He's considered one of the great horror film directors. And of course, like all directors, there were projects he wanted to do that didn't happen.
Sure.
And I was able to locate all of his notes and the script drafts for for a film that he never made. And it's a forthcoming book, and it's called Revolt of the Dead. Mm-hmm. And of course, Browning lived through the pandemic of 1918-19. And his film Revolt of the Dead seems like it's harkening back to the 1918 epidemic, because it's about a kind of a voodoo witch doctor that wants to turn the whole world into the living dead. Mm. And it would spread across the whole world, you know, like a 28 Days Later, like a World War Z, you know. And he's basically wanting to create, albeit with kind of a supernatural origin, a kind of pandemic of the living dead. And in the script, increasingly, people start getting knocks on their door from dead relatives who aren't the same. People go to movie theaters, they go to restaurants, they go to the nightclubs where, you know, people used to maybe go more often for dancing and music. Mm. And soon the dead, infected dead, overpopulate the living. And in a scary way, you literally, in this script, you go to a restaurant and there are more dead people at it than there are the living. And so this is kind of, I think, what you're talking about, you know, that it's a, I think it's an interesting dance where it's back and forth, you know. I mean, I think as so often he was in horror, you know, Poe, again, with The Mask of the Red Death, was kind of prescient, ahead of the game in some ways, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's fascinating. It's horrifying, but it's very from a scholarly terms, as well as, I think, movie-going terms, audience terms. You know, these things can help us. I think that's one of the great things about horror. The potentiality of horror is to be cathartic, mm-hmm. to be scared through entertainment, but maybe from the safety of our home sofa.
Yeah, that's it. That's probably a good place then to ask you about probably one of your best-known books, to be The Birth of the American Horror Film, because certainly those of us who are young, we think we invented everything. And actually, as you say, it started right at the start of cinema. I suppose for anybody listening who might be under the misconception that old films and silent films are very stuffy and straight-laced, what would you say about that?
Well, I'm always looking for ideas here about convincing people of the merits of going back to look at earlier eras of film, and even how to work with young filmmakers and young film students and so forth, you know, how to get them interested in periods before, for example, in the 21st century, and especially a period of black and white cinema, a period of even silent films, the earliest days of cinema. And I don't know the best approach to getting people. I've tried various mechanisms to get them excited, but I think there's a few ways that I try, and not least of which is the fact that some of the best known filmmakers today, certainly in the Western world, certainly in my home country of America, would be people like Martin Scorsese and Quentin Tarantino, filmmakers whose films and their careers, their interviews, everything about them exemplify that their achievements, and I don't mean to limit to just those two, but they're two examples of names most people, I think, know. Their films constantly reference, build upon the tradition of cinema. They are lifelong students of film history, and they, of course, attribute their success in some measure to their knowledge of film history. And we can go back through so many other filmmakers where I think that's true as well. Some of the great filmmakers are among the biggest collectors of film history and film memorabilia and so forth, because they love the cinema. And if you love the cinema, there's not a starting date on it. In other words, you can love films made before the year 2000. And I think also I would say to younger filmmakers, or trying to convince people, and to share my hopefully boundless enthusiasm and passion, is if you're wanting to make great films, the film genres we love have existed so long, be it comedy or horror, as we've already said, or others. If you're wanting to develop script ideas, if you're wanting to think about cinema and your own ideas, being part of these genres, indeed, we could argue that film itself is a genre. I argue that in the same way Mikhail Bakhtin mm-hmm. used to argue that the novel was a genre, whatever its topic or focus, be it a Western novel or a, you know, a drama or what have you. But that all of film, in other words, what I would try to argue is that you can find incredible ideas in the past that can be, because genre is always reinvention. It's building on what has been done before. The cinema is about that. Sometimes, obviously, in the form of direct remakes, you know, as we talk, a new Texas Chainsaw Massacre film is about to come out. The first one was made in the 70s. So sometimes this, of course, most obviously happens with direct remakes, but it can happen in more vague ways with storylines, with themes. It can happen even with, you know, I grew up loving George Lucas. There's still this Star Wars universe, multiverse, whatever it is, universe, I suppose, with The Mandalorian, everybody loves. And The Mandalorian is doing what Lucas did in the 70s by using using a lot of wipe transitions that had fallen out of favor for decades, but that he loved from the 1930s films and serials he watched. And so it doesn't even have to be about finding old storylines that are interesting. It'd be about finding film techniques that were popular once upon a time, but not as much now. And so I think here is an endless fountain, an incredible reservoir of possible inspiration of all types for young filmmakers, even in direct terms. Right before I came to Ireland, the spring before I came, I arrived in Ireland, in the north of Ireland that fall in Belfast at Queen's, and met you and so many wonderful students. The previous spring, I had my last group of American students, and one of them wanted to make a short film called Director's Cut that was going to be a short horror movie. And the cut was going to have in the title more than one meaning, as you can gather probably quickly, you know, the slasher type, cut him up, horror film. He got fairly far along before he realized, and then I met him and had to relay the unfortunate news that there had already been a film called Director's Cut that was a horror film that, at least in the most basic idea that you get from that title, it had been done before. And so I think even if you're committed to doing something extraordinarily new, perhaps you're interested in avant-garde or experimental, you want to do something that's never been done before, it does help to know film history so you're not reinventing the wheel, as that student was trying to do. And fortunately, then he moved on to another project, and that was wonderful for him. But he had gotten far along before I met him with something that was unknowingly copying the past. So if you are going to work with the past, it's best to do it, of course, in a very knowing way, which is one of the things, of course, that we love about people like Quentin Tarantino, and again, so many other filmmakers that work in this same kind of way.
So I wanted to ask you about your work on Bela Lugosi, because you've written probably, I don't know, maybe the most comprehensive biographies of Lugosi. And Lugosi is a figure that we, certainly anyone who knows their stuff about horror film, they know who that is. So I was wondering if you would mind, if there are any listeners, maybe younger listeners, who don't know who we're talking about, or, you know, as you mentioned earlier, he was Dracula. He was Dracula.
Yes.
And Todd Browning's Dracula, you know, and that was back with the Universal horror, the creature features, in a way, that they were doing in the 1930s, but that was, you know, one of the first ones, wasn't it?
Yes.
But that wasn't all he did. He had such an extensive career and quite a tumultuous life, I think, as well. I mean, would you be happy to tell us a bit about?
Yes. Well, I would love to, and I suppose in different periods, Lugosi has been known for different reasons. For example, when I first met you, and I was first starting to work with some of the first-year students in Ireland in courses like Introduction to Film, I would sometimes show them Tim Burton's movie Ed Wood, because it depicted Lugosi at a very tragic late period in his life. It was a Tim Burton film that dramatized, you know, starring Johnny Depp and Martin Landau, that dramatized the most tragic period of Lugosi's life. And I would show it to first year students then, because they would remember that the film had come out when they were 10 years old or had heard about it. And of course, now it's much further in time from the release of that film. And it was, in other words, a bit of a more modern touchstone for me to talk about Lugosi then, and now it's very much passed into the past, so to speak,
from another century.
It's now we're much further past that, but more than 25 years, I guess. Talking with people who may not know Lugosi, I suppose now the best way is the way that most people have historically known who he is throughout the world, and I think it connects a little bit with our last exchange, because it is a way in which film and, by extension, popular culture so often reinvents or builds on the past, even in ways that sometimes audiences aren't aware. In America, this past Halloween, there was a commercial for a candy bar, we would call them here, chocolate bar, I think you might say, called Kit Kat. Our colleague Des O'Raw used to eat them every morning when I would have tea with him. So they're known elsewhere in the world, but they're popular. They were popular here in America. And there was a commercial, a 30-second TV commercial, where Dracula, in the usual dress, the cape, the clean face shape, shaven face, pretty good looking, hair slicked back, black hair, and affecting a kind of an Eastern European, kind of Hungarian / Romanian accent, was on there touting, and of course wanting to sink his teeth into a Kit Kat candy bar. And that commercial is, even though Bela Lugosi died in 1956, that commercial was him. in a sense, refracted at least through popular culture, reincarnated through popular culture. There is a children's cereal in America known as Count Chocula, and its mascot from the 1970s until today is another of those imitators, I suppose is another term we could use. There's an extent to which even later Draculas, although still not known necessarily to younger people, later Draculas of the screen, like Christopher Lee and Frank Langella, their depictions of Dracula drew upon Lugosi, particularly to the extent that in Bram Stoker's novel, Dracula was very different in appearance than the way we think of Dracula, including on that Kit Kat commercial. That anytime anybody affects the voice, the cape, so much of what we think of Dracula in popular culture is not from Bram Stoker, but rather from Bela Lugosi. Mm-hmm. So the Dracula most people know most readily, rather than say the long white mustache that he has in Stoker's novel, it's much more Lugosi, who played him in the 1931 film previous to that on Broadway. Mm-hmm. And he turned Dracula in some ways a monster, yes, a supernatural vampire, yes, but into this kind of alluring, sexualized vampire. So much of folklore, the vampire was often repulsive. And obviously vampires do repulsive things, you know, biting people, drinking their blood, yada, yada. But Lugosi really turned the vampire. And I think we see this again in ways like there's a character named Bella in Twilight films.
Oh, yes.
And yes, yeah, you know, and yes, different than Lugosi. And Bela would be the proper pronunciation, as you, of course, rightly do. In America, in a lot of places, people did refer to him throughout his career as Bela Lugosi. But regardless, this whole notion that the vampire could be sensual, that the vampire could be sexualized and attractive, and even hypnotic. Another aspect of the vampire we think about are often the hypnotic eyes. And in films throughout the decades, sometimes this coincides with cinematography to have the extreme close-up of the eyes, penetrating eyes, hypnotic eyes, and victims who sometimes maybe don't mind being the victim because the vampire, and in later films even as women vampires, but the vampire becomes so sexualized and attractive and sexy, frankly, in the 20th century until now. But all of that begins really, most of that, I should say, not all, but most of that begins with Lugosi's on-screen depiction in 1931. And in various respects, he keeps playing the role throughout the rest of his life to the extent that he was literally buried in his Dracula cape. So much were the two intertwined. And my old saying, and I don't want to self-plagiarize, but I think if you announce it, you can say it, because I've written more than once that in life, Lugosi played Dracula. After his death, Dracula has played Lugosi. And by that, I mean that again, what we think of as Dracula is as much or more Lugosi as it is Bram Stoker. Mm-hmm. That's who he was. And I saw those spooky movies on television as a little child, and they thrilled me in the same way, I guess, ghost stories so often thrill little children. I grew up when they were still showing black and white films on TV. So I started seeing him in the late 70s, even though he was by then long since deceased, and got fascinated and have gone on, as you kindly point out, to write about him. And that's been a great deal of fun. And some of the projects that have come out of that have been enjoyable.
I think that Dracula, it's a nice example of quite an early sound era film. The sound era was quite firmly established, I think, by that point. And I think they were doing some very exciting things with audio at that time. I think it's something that you covered, I remember, in teaching, was the influence of a lot of emigre directors, because a lot of the directors we're talking about who were making these films were British, or they were German or Austrian or that sort of thing. So, you know, there's that influx of that expressionist trend coming over.
Oh, yes.
Quite a bit too.
Yes.
When I was last teaching, I taught M. I showed it for sound.
Oh yes.
You know, so I thought it was a nice example of a film from that early sound era that was actually really challenging the technology at the time.
Yes.
You know, I was wondering if that was something that you thought of. I know you don't maybe necessarily deal with the aesthetics so much.
No, I love it. And the aesthetics are so much a wonderful part of the horror film and of film history. And even the history of aesthetics becomes, I think, so fascinating, as you're rightly pointing out. And I love it, and I do try to write about it. And I love the period you're talking about, because, you know, there's moments in film, and I think some of us have lived through it, with the rise of CGI, the rise of digital projection, the rise of motion capture, where new technologies cause a major change to cinema. And this happens, I think, in some ways very much constantly. You know, the film theorist André Bazin used to say that film is constantly evolving, which meant, in his mind, and I'm paraphrasing, that film has yet to be invented.
Exactly.
Because it's always turning, as he said rightly, into something else. But even if it's always turning into something else, I think what you're pointing out that's so crucial is there are particular moments of major technological upheaval that cause much more maybe profound change than at other moments. And the introduction of sound was very clearly one of them. But on that point, the period you're pointing out of early sound is so profound because, and I write about it in my next forthcoming journal article is for the Journal of Popular Film Music, and it's about the second all-talking film in America, which was called The Terror, and it was released in the second half of 1928. A lot of people would have even seen it in the Halloween season of 1928, and it was based on a story by Edgar Wallace, and it was one of these kind of, we would call them old dark house stories that were popular at the time, where a lot of people gather either at an old house or at an old hotel in the middle of the night, people start getting killed, and even if the killer turns out to be just somebody wearing a mask, there's the feeling that maybe there's the supernatural is at play and so forth. It was the first of what we, I suppose, in retrospect would call a horror movie in sound. And it's playing with sound. Now, it doesn't do it nearly as well as M, because your use of M is the very best example of the period, and obviously by one of the master directors and one of the master directors who became an emigre, as you rightly point out, to Hollywood. And there were some of the others like Carl Freund, who had worked with Lang, the great cinematographer who came from Germany to America, ended up shooting Dracula in 1931. He ended up directing one of the early Universal horrors that followed Dracula, which was The Mummy in 1932. And some people will probably think of it, maybe the Tom Cruise version or something in recent times as part of the remakes or the reinventions of these. But so much of that was with the immigrant culture or stories coming from other countries. And The Terror was a British story. But what it most interestingly did, it's a lost film, but we have the sound discs because some of the first talkies, they would have what was basically the equivalent of a large record. If you can imagine a large audio record, music record, and it would play in sync with the film being projected. It was not a great system. I mean, if somebody bumped the needle, the sound would be asynchronous and a problem. But for some early talkies, even if they're lost films, where we cannot watch the films, there's photographs from The Terror, but we can't watch it. But the sound discs are there.
That's so cool.
And I was able to access them and write about them for the first time. And we start to get what you would probably expect in film sound, but we still get, and we'll get it in, I suspect, like the next Conjuring film or what have you. And that is the sound of the human scream. For the first time, we get the sound of the scream. But we also get the sound of the storm, the sound of heavy wind through the trees. And some of these sounds that we associate, and certainly before film sound, people associated with things that were frightening, you know, a lightning bolt or whatever that might frighten a child or, you know, a pet dog or whatever. And they start to show up in The Terror the very first time. And it becomes very quickly adopted as an aesthetic in subsequent mystery horror films in 1929 and 30, to the extent that by 1930, there was a comedy short that you can find on YouTube called The Laurel Hardy Murder Case with Laurel and Hardy. And they're in an old house in the middle of the night, spooky things happen. It's all a takeoff on this same story. You know, to an extent, Knives Out in more recent times has done some of this. So again, you know, this never goes away. It keeps being reinvented. But in the Laurel and Hardy version, they so overdo the sound effects as to parody them. And it's a fascinating example in 1930, only a couple of years after, you know, a few years after sound film, that we're already like we're laying it on extra thick for the joke. And then Todd Browning immediately after makes Dracula in sound, which you were asking about. And he forgoes heavy thunder and lightning. He forgoes spooky music in favor of much more subtle sound effects, like complete quiet, except the creaking of the coffin lid opening, and trying to be much more restrained. And it's so interesting because at such an early point in film sound, relatively speaking, I mean, you know, 3-4 years, he's pulling back rather than laying it on thick. And so it's interesting how these things, you know, can sometimes evolve quickly and how much aesthetics play a role in the horror film, including sound, whether it's the spooky music or the spooky sound effects.
Or the silence, indeed.
Or the silence. And that's what some of us love the most, or sometimes in horror films. It's another reason to think so wonderfully particularly about silent films. It's a reason to think about parts of Dracula, the Todd Browning, which are no music, no dialogue. I think one of the interesting things, and we I guess have the old phrase, the old slang phrase, you know, that silence speaks volumes, or phrases like that. You know, in America, I grew up hearing phrases like that. Maybe it was to get me to shut up as a kid. But you know, it was, you know, that I think that's one of the great things. It's like, you know, when you can have a special effect, when you can have moving camera, sometimes filmmakers forget that they can let it stay still.
Yeah.
When you can cut extremely rapidly, filmmakers sometimes forget that they can have slow paced editing. Mm-hmm. When you can do anything with film sound, the incredible possibilities. Mm-hmm. Now, we can forget, sadly, what you've just rightly mentioned, which is silence can be so very powerful, even when the first impulse is to have 12 tracks or more of audio going at once. But just because you can use technology in a certain way doesn't mean we always, you know, have to. And so that's a wonderful point. And it's certainly, I think, very salient for horror films, you know.
You mentioned a bit earlier, it might be nice to see what your connection with Irish cinema is, because it may not seem immediately obvious, horror and early cinema and Irish cinema. I was wondering if we could get into that, because I think there are a lot of connections there. I suppose a nice segue would probably be Interview with a Vampire, Neil Jordan. If we need a segue.
Yes, yes.
That absolutely might be a way to connect a couple of these things. When we first met, you were teaching Irish cinema, and that really sparked a massive interest in me, because I'd had an interest in Irish literature when I was at school, and then was really keen to carry that on because I did an English and film degree. So I was doing Irish literature and Irish film and that sort of thing. So I was wondering what's your interest then in Irish cinema?
Well, I really appreciate that question, and you remind me so happily of my arrival in Ireland, but also, though I try to be unflappable, that's impossible. And one of the spookiest moments, and not in a horror film spooky, but I guess you'd say nervous moments, was when I walked in to teach that course, because I felt a little out of place, not only as an immigrant myself and living in another country for the first time, but I felt a little, I would have never wanted to seem presumptuous in teaching a course on Irish cinema in Ireland. Mm-hmm. I had taught Irish cinema actually in America previous a couple of times, but that was a bit nervous actually going in to teach all of you, because I thought, gosh, I feel ill at ease or ill-informed maybe, you know, to take that on since as an American in Belfast. But I suppose my interest would be twofold. And one, I think it started with horror. And there's certainly these tremendous connections between horror and Ireland, Irish literature, Irish folklore, from obviously The Banshee through a film I saw. And I don't think a lot of Irish film scholars, I don't know that any of them ever really talked about it much. But when I was 10, 12 years old, I was in love with horror movies. I was also in love with Francis Ford Coppola, who had directed the Godfather films and Apocalypse Now. And early in his career, he had made a film called Dementia 13.
Oh, right.
Early 1960s. Mm. And it was a gothic horror story set in Ireland. Mm-hmm. And it was actually shot in Ireland. And, you know, it's readily available on YouTube. It's a rather well-known film in terms of Coppola studies, because it was basically a second film. But I think in Irish film studies, it's completely unknown. I mean, but the connections go deeper. I mean, Stoker was Anglo-Irish. There's such a great tradition of Irish Gothic novels. Mm-hmm. And as I grew in my interest in horror, I grew in my interest in horror literature as well as horror films. So there's all these fantastic connections in Irish horror stories on film. But the other thing that happened to me when I was a teenager was by about the age of 13. And of course, you know, I grew up in the state of Oklahoma. I grew up in a town that in American terms, certainly most terms, we'd probably consider a small town of 25,000 people. I grew up in, I guess I'm trying to think of the best way to say it, but as a Native American and everything, you know, kind of a masculine type culture in that terms or that parameters. And so John Huston's films spoke to me greatly as a teenager. His films like The Maltese Falcon and African Queen, and these films with Humphrey Bogart, who was one of the great cinema tough guys. And, you know, his later films like The Man Who Would Be King with Sean Connery and Michael Caine. And, you know, you can kind of probably quickly understand maybe or see that, you know, kind of, okay, a lot of his films and his life too. Mm-hmm. I became fascinated by Huston's life. He was quite an explorer and hunter and, you know, very masculine and all of that. Very much a Hemingway. He was kind of the Hemingway of 20th century American cinema. And he was deeply interested in Irish literature. Mm-hmm. And by the time I was in high school, he was making his film The Dead. based upon Joyce.
Yeah.
And there was an incredible documentary film made about him, Houston, and it showed the behind the scenes footage. It showed him talking at length. This was before the kind of making of featurettes we know today. By and large, there were some examples, but they weren't, you know, it was before DVD. It was before that cottage industry, so to speak. So I became entranced. By the time I was 16 and 17, I became entranced with James Joyce and the dead. When Houston said in his mind it was probably the greatest short story ever written in the English language, that spoke volumes to me. The film version he made, which I found to be quite faithful. I'm talking at length for a question and getting boring, but my interest came from these different angles, from horror as well as Joyce. And then about that same time, Beckett, because I was also one of my other favorites as a teenager was Buster Keaton.
Mm-hmm.
And Samuel Beckett had made a Keaton film, later in Keaton's life, of course, and a kind of avant-garde film. And I was also getting entranced, you know, and it's easy to romanticize thing when you're a teenager and and the passion for it all. And I was getting interested in Beckett because of his work with Keaton. And I was particularly intrigued because Kevin Brownlow had made this incredible documentary about Keaton. And he had footage of Keaton's saying, you know, he didn't even understand the film he made with Beckett, you know,
which I think
and I'm thinking,
film.
Yes, he's one of the... yeah, exactly. Yeah. And here's one of the genius filmmakers in my mind, Keaton.
Yeah.
But he's saying he didn't quite even understand it, but he liked Beckett and everything. And so I was coming at Ireland from all these different directions.
Yeah. Wow.
And then to conclude, I would say that in the 1990s, America has always had this love affair with Ireland.
Yeah.
There's regrettable exceptions during some immigration periods, maybe in the 19th century and so forth. But there's been a lot of love affairs in the later 20th century, certainly from, everybody, celebrating St. Patrick's Day to the 90s when the commitments, particularly the film version, U2, there was a particular love affair with, it had happened different times before in the 60s, I think, with JFK for a lot of people. But in the 90s, it was like there was Neil Jordan and Jim Sheridan's films were exploding onto the scene.
Yeah.
My Left Foot had won, the Academy Award. And of course, I was graduating from high school and about to start university right at that moment. Then there's U2. And then I particularly fell in love. Like I heard it on the radio and I was driving. I remember the moment so clearly. I was driving down I-40 in Oklahoma City, an interstate that runs throughout a lot of America. And I'm burning down the highway in an old car, the only one I could afford at the time. But I'm burning down the highway and this voice comes on the radio, this band.
Mm.
And I hear it, but I didn't know the name. And I had to ask a friend later that day, who is singing this? And it was the Cranberries.
I thought you were going to say that.
You guessed it. You're always ahead of me. But, I heard, and including that kind of Irish wailing at the end
like
of the song, which went from the Irish, but meeting pop music to an even more Irish sound at the end. And it just seemed to speak to me in ways. And again, as a more romantic young person, romantic maybe more in the German sense of that term, my great-grandfather was from Ireland.
Mm-hmm.
His name was McCord. So I'm Cherokee and mainly that, but I have a McCord whose family was actually from the north of Ireland, even though he came to America from Cork. And I met him once as a little tiny child. I barely remember he fought in World War I, all of that. And so I had that connection to Ireland as well. So forgive this long biography autobiography. But there were so many ways that I fell in love with this. And then I fell in love with an Irish woman who was in America and all roads led, and they had to lead where they had to lead. And it was this tremendous love affair. I cannot tell you how achingly I miss Carrickfergus.
Oh, yeah.
One of my favorite places. How much I miss the Belfast city center, the people there. There's so many Dunluce. There were so many places I liked to go and go repeatedly. Just an unending love affair.
If it helps any, just thinking back to you saying you felt a bit, this American coming in and telling these Irish students about Irish cinema. I don't think one of us ever thought that. Not one of us ever thought that. We were all really excited that it was like, he's American. He's a real American. Because so many of us hadn't met an actual American person.
Yes.
So many of us just hadn't traveled very much. And a lot of us had never even met people from the other side of Belfast because we were that generation that was emerging from the conflict.
Yes.
This is 2005 and stuff. So things were really only just opening up properly at that point because it took a few years after the agreement really, and a lot of us had it was the first time I ever had friends from West Belfast, for example. I'd never really met anybody from that far away before, and then suddenly there's this bona fide American who's proper American, you know, and it was so exciting for us. You were like,
well,
a movie star.
Sometimes maybe improper, but you're too kind. But it was, such a joy because everyone was so welcoming. I mean, that was one of the great things about living there, yeah, in general, was the generosity and the charity and the welcoming nature of the entirety of the island. You know, it was just like a beautiful thing. So it's so nice to hear that. And it did seem like such a fascinating moment at that point. One of my biggest memories of Belfast at that moment was the sheer number of cranes.
Oh, yes.
Construction, yeah, cranes around a city. It seemed like a truly under construction, yeah, obviously, and reconstruction with the cranes, but it felt to an outsider and admittedly neophyte's eyes to Belfast, it seemed almost as metaphorical as it did physical,
yeah,
the construction cranes and this coming together of peoples. And I suppose some of my great memories then would have been with the film students and how film students working together on projects,
mm-hmm,
from those two different communities and film production or film studies,
mm-hmm,
you know, bringing them together. It was really a remarkable moment,
yeah,
in Belfast, you know, it really was.
It's so nice to remember all that. Actually, it's so good to hear your side of it. I mean, we all just felt like kids, you know, so we didn't know where you'd come from or anything. And it was back at that time when I think students and certainly undergrad students had reverence for whoever was teaching them. It didn't matter who they were, what age they were,
yes,
or whatever. The person at the front of the class was the authority and that was it. I mean, we didn't even think to question anything like that. Whereas I think it's become very different. Certainly my experience was very different when I was,
yes,
teaching.
Yes.
It's so good to hear it from your experience as well, because I think we, even though we were from there, it was all new to us as well. So it's really interesting to think about it that way.
Yeah, well, it was a wonderful period and one of my favorite periods, you know, as we look back, and there's sometimes a few years that we're so happy here and sometimes maybe a year or two that's not and so forth. It was one of the happiest periods in my life, and a lot of it was Queens and was film at Queens and was all of you there. And of course, you know, the tremendous colleagues who were there at that time, like Des O'Raw and Raymond,
mm-hmm,
and there were, you know, some people who were no longer even at Queens. They'd moved on or retired, but it was quite a wonderful meeting of everyone.
I think so, yeah. I have very special memories too. So Gary, is there anything we haven't covered that you would like to touch on?
Oh no, I'm just so thankful for your time and having me, allowing me the chance to chat too much. But I love talking about, obviously, all these issues,
yeah,
and so it's great to have the opportunity to do so.
I've so enjoyed it. It's been great because, I mean, we've known each other for a long time, but I think this is the first time I've heard a lot of all of that. So it's been really a treat for me, and it's been so good to catch up. It's been a while, and yeah, it's good to reminisce as well about home with somebody who loves it as much,
yes,
as I do.
Yes. Yes, indeed. And well, and to even hear your accent now, I'm back to hearing American accents every day, and some of them are quite nice, but I miss the accents of
people
Belfast
talking like this at you. What are you giving it?
Well, but it was such a beautiful thing. It really, the Irish accents from throughout the island and peoples are so beautiful and almost melodic,
yeah,
to hear. And I miss that so much. I had to, you know, with some of the Belfast people talking so quickly, I had to listen very carefully, but I got better at it over time. So it's great to hear even the accent I miss so much.
Well, it's great to hear you too. Yeah, I can't thank you enough for your time doing this. It's been really, really fun, and I hope really informative for lots of people as well. It certainly has been for me. Just thank you, and take care, and all the best with everything you're working on.
Thanks so very much. All the best to you and all of the listeners, including as we trudge out, hopefully soon, the last of the pandemic.
This has been a Cozy Peapod production with me, Paula Blair. The music is Common Ground by Airtone, used under a 3.0 non-commercial Creative Commons license, and is available at ccmixter.org. To find out more, listen to episodes, sign up for our free monthly newsletter, and to get in touch, visit audiovisualcultures.wordpress.com. For extras and previews, see patreon.com/avcultures. And to support us, go to supporter.acast.com audiovisual-cultures-podcast. Thank you so much for listening, sharing, subscribing, and rating. Take care, and I'll catch you next time.